Everybody in the vinyl community, how is everyone doing today? Today I want to take a look at the year 1979 in the music business. And, you know, I had a video several months ago. I think it was called New Wave in Four Acts. And if I remember correctly, I think I focused on the years 82 and 83. And I showed four different albums that I thought were essential albums that anyone should have in their collection when we talk about New Wave. But if I turn back the clock and go to 1979, I'm going to show bands that were power pop, on the cusp of New Wave, maybe even moving out of New Wave at that point in time. But one of the things I did with the prior video, the reason I call it In Four Acts is I used some live video clips that I'm going to do again today to try and help cement my point, because it's awesome to listen to some of the songs that a talking head is talking about, and it kind of cements home the feelings and emotions that I might try to convey a little bit easier if we listen to a snippet or two. Because that's the important thing about music, right? It's the emotional connection. It's the memories that this music can help resurface. Or maybe you don't even have a memory of that music. Maybe you're new to the music and you're just discovering it. In any event, there is emotion here. And it's one of the more important things that I love about music, and something that continues to drive my quest for discovering new music and rediscovering old music. I've gone on way too long in this intro. Let's get started. That, of course, was Blondie from 1979 touring behind their fourth album, Eat to the Beat. This came out on the Chrysalis label. I have a very first issue pressing, Santa Maria Press. It sounds amazing. And, you know, there are three or four standout songs, first of all, on this album. They recorded this in the spring of 1971. I think it was between the months of March and May in 1979. They probably ran into John Lennon and Yoko in that same time period, because they were recording in New York City at the Power Station Studios. The album was later released in September, and this thing would stay on the Billboard charts for over 200 weeks. So it was a very strong album all the way into the next year, 1980. But that clip, Union City Blues, it's anthemic, it's emotional. Clem Burke on drums, what a powerhouse. And Debbie Harry, you kind of forget sometimes, you know, people probably flip through used bins and flip over this album every day. You need to pick this up if you don't have it, because there is a lot of emotion in here. Right off the bat, the lead-off track, Dreaming, probably, it is a masterpiece, and it's probably one of Blondie's, one of Debbie Harry's greatest songs ever, that she ever wrote, that she ever composed, along with the band. Again, Clem Burke on drums. You know, Debbie Harry's, at one point, life partner, writing partner, Chris Stein, had a lot to do with that song as well. But Dreaming and Union City Blues, two of the strongest emotional, non-ironic songs in the Blondie catalog. When I mean non-ironic, I mean they're coming from the heart. There's a lot of emotion there. We're not talking about experimental excursions into rap like Rapture. This is from the heart, straight up power pop rock and roll music. Just an incredible album. Back to Dreaming on the third verse. Famously, she brought in Ellie Greenwich to sing backup. And that song has borrowed a lot from the 60s girl groups. And Ellie Greenwich, of course, famously co-wrote the Do Run Run and Be My Baby. Unfortunately died in 2009, but she lent an incredible background vocal to Dreaming. And every time I hear that, and I haven't heard this album in a while, I was just thinking I wanted to take a look at the year 1980 and pull this from the collection, threw it on the turntable. First of all, this thing powers out of the speakers. It sounds amazing. And the sheer emotion of Dreaming coupled with Union City Blues, followed by Shayla, which is a kind of a slow burn ballad. A great, 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 I think, overlooked album, Eat to the Beat, Blondie, released in September 1979. This is Candy O, the second Cars album. This was mastered at Sterling Sound by George Mariano. If you have an early first press, you'll see Sterling in the Dead Wax. This thing sounds amazing. And right off the bat, we've got Let's Go, the lead-off track from side one, from the exacting economic backbeat of David Robinson to Ben Orr's incredible vocal on that song. You've got some tasty Elliot Easton guitar work going on. And anyone who had any doubts after the Cars debut album in 1978, 1 year before, they were erased when they put this song on their turntable, this album. And that song just kind of announced to the world, hell yes, this is no joke. The Cars are for real. Every song was written by the genius Rick Ocasek, R.I.P., and this album really holds up well. It's fantastic from front to bottom. I love side two. There's some quirky stuff, Lust for Kicks. The Dangerous Type is a tour de force as well. And the third song on side one, I want to talk about just for a minute too. It's All I Can Do. Another Ben Orr vocal on that song. But the star of the show, well, there's two stars. It's going to be Greg Hawkes with that kind of soaring keyboard synth line that kind of hovers over the chorus. And Elliot Easton, man. Elliot Easton, what a guitar player. He delivers all of these incredible solos in you know, an economic time frame. He's not noodling on and on forever. He gets in there, lays down an incredible solo, and is out in eight bars. So props to Elliot Easton. Anyway, this is Candy O from The Cars, their second album released in 1979. The third Talking Heads album, of course, it was Fear of Music. And, you know, when the Talking Heads got together following the previous album and they booked some studio time, and basically they came out of that feeling kind of empty. They didn't think they had much going on, and they decided to move to Chris and Tina's loft. They had a loft in Long Island City. Cheap rent, if they were paying rent, who knows at that point in time. But the band moved there, and they ended up calling Brian Eno, who had produced the previous album. And they thought, well, let's get Eno back and see what we have here. And what they came up with is one of the greatest albums ever released, one of the top three or four Talking Heads albums, in my opinion. And the centerpiece of this album is Heaven. So Heaven is a Bowie-esque, soaring, emotional ballad. David Byrne has a fantastic lyric on it. It's an emotional song. It's indescribable. I don't know what else I can say about it. If you haven't heard...
Everyone is trying to get to the bar. Name of the bar. The bar is called Heaven. The band in Heaven, they play my favorite song. Play it one more time.
We, of course, have Life During Wartime, which has got a similar feel and builds from the success of Take Me to the River off of the previous album. I love that slow fade-in on Cities. And side two, Memories Can't Wait. It's got a real kind of a foreboding, atmospheric feel to it. Atmospheric feel. Anyway, that is Fear of Music, co-produced by the band and Brian Eno. Of course, they started to expand a little bit here with this album as well. They brought in Robert Fripp on lead guitar on a couple different songs, kind of moving to expand that sound. Of course, it led off with that famous iZimbra with the intricate kind of off-kilter rhythms and a very unique vocal by David Byrne. Fantastic album. 1979, Fear of Music.
Wish I walked through this wicked world, searching for light in darkness and insanity. And I ask myself, is all hope lost? Is there only pain, hatred, and disease? Every time I feel like this inside, one thing I wanna know, what's so funny about peace, love, and understanding? Oh, what's so funny about peace, love, and understanding?
That is the unmistakable, indescribable, anthemic What's So Funny About Peace, Love, and Understanding, written, of course, by Nick Lowe, perfected by Elvis Costello and the Attractions. Nick Lowe even said in interviews that if Costello didn't cover that song, it probably would have fell by the wayside and nobody would remember it today. But people remember it incredibly. It's high. It ranks high as far as anthems are concerned, as far as a rock and roll emotional anthem. What's So Funny About Peace, Love, and Understanding? So Elvis Costello and the Attractions actually recorded that. It was a B-side of a Nick Lowe single from 1978. And Armed Forces was released in the UK. And by the time it came time to press and release the album in the United States in 1979, they decided to swap out one of the songs on Armed Forces, the UK Running Order, and slap on What's So Funny About Peace, Love, and Understanding, because it was doing so well. Radio stations were picking it up and playing that song many more times, the B-side, over that Nick Lowe single, which the title of is escaping me right now. Also, a fantastic, comprehensive statement from Elvis Costello. What more can you say about Costello and the Attractions? One thing I will say on that song, Peace, Love, and Understanding, the drumming of Pete Thomas is incredible. It sounds like in various portions of that song that it's about ready to go off the rails, but Pete Thomas kind of reins things in and keeps things organized, as only, an organized drummer, beat person can do. Similar to, Keith Moon had an incredible style, whereby you would think some songs are about ready to kind of go off the reservation, but between Entwistle and Moon, they were able to kind of buoy that song, Entwistle, with that incredible lead bass playing, and Moon, realizing when he had to kind of bring things back to the center. That was an interesting Who tangent. did they have an album in 79? Was Face Dances in 79? It may have been. All right, that is Armed Forces, Elvis Costello and the Attractions with the incredible song, What's So Funny About Peace, Love, and Understanding. This is Face Dances. This came out in 1981. I had to do a double take because I did think, wait a minute, did Face Dances come out in 79? It did not. So we're going to hold on to this and talk about this in a future video. Hey, that's 1979 in four acts. I hope you enjoyed this. Hopefully it will stir your memory, or if you're new to any of this music, maybe inspire you to go check it out. All of those four albums that I showed today can be easily found in used bins all over America, especially. That's where I'm based. But I would imagine you would not have trouble finding those in the UK, Germany, Canada, in other places, wherever used records are sold. Thank you very much for watching today. I'm going to be back very soon with a couple other videos that I've been working on diligently here in the background. Remember, this is the most esteemed higher education channel in the vinyl community. Don't forget that. This is Tim from the University of Vinyl signing off for now and saying see you soon.